How often do you think about pain? And I mean physical body pain, not psychological pain from dealing with someone who is a complete pain in the neck. Statistically speaking, most of you don't have to do it very often. We all know pain, however, because we all experience it at some point. As a rheumatologist, I evaluate and treat patients in pain from various causes and autoimmune rheumatic diseases. I get to see patients in pain every day. Chronic pain is a huge problem in healthcare across all specialties. It affects about 1 out of 5 adults in the United States and globally. I measure the cost of chronic pain by the amount of suffering my patients and myself have gone through. US economists measure the cost in billions of dollars lost every year in lost productivity. I'm here to talk to you about 4 fundamental principles of chronic pain and a novel approach to treatment. Emilia, a young photographer, was referred to me for concern about lupus. Lupus is an autoimmune rheumatic disease and can be deadly. Her primary care provider was concerned about lupus because Emilia has had muscle, joint pain, and fatigue for over 4 years. Her pain was throughout her body, sometimes severe. She always felt tired. Between the pain and fatigue, she had trouble performing her job and just enjoying her life. Add the concern about lupus, she was obviously worried. I was able to do a thorough evaluation and able to reassure her that she didn't have lupus, but rather fibromyalgia. Fibromyalgia, an F word in rheumatology, is one of many chronic pain conditions. It means having daily widespread body pain without any evidence of tissue damage or inflammation. It affects at least 4 million people in the United States, mostly women. And as if the pain was not bad enough, it comes along with a bunch of other symptoms, including fatigue, trouble sleeping, trouble focusing, abdominal pain, bladder pain, numbness and tingling. The list goes on. If this sounds miserable to you, it really is. The real chronic pain lies in the loss of hope these people experience when they look and cannot find answers for their pain. Many give up. They accept their lives as defined by pain. They believe the message that they are powerless over their pain. I'm here to tell you otherwise. The first principle of chronic pain is this: the pain is 100% real, despite no tissue damage, injury, or inflammation. For the longest time, the disconnect between the reported pain and no objective evidence on exam, it caused skepticism in the medical community. Many healthcare professionals questioned the realness of pain. However, 2 decades of neuroscience brain research on pain have consistently proven the pain is real by showing changes on functional brain MRIs. Which leads me to the second principle of chronic pain. The pain comes from our brain. Let me explain. Imagine you just poured a hot boiling coffee on your hand. Ouch, it hurts. The source of your pain is in the hand. The information about the burnt skin is communicated to your brain by neurons. Neurons are the principal cells of nervous system, and they connect our body to our brain and spinal cord. And those two regulate all of our pain. We are biologically wired to view pain as dangerous, and for a good reason. If we did not have this defensive mechanism, we would all be dead. People with rare genetic condition of not being able to feel pain die young or suffer multiple injuries in childhood. Pain leads us away from danger and promotes healing. In chronic pain conditions, pain serves no such purpose. It's created or amplified in the brain and felt in the body. If you're confused by what you just heard, that's normal. My patient's first reaction is like that too. In chronic pain conditions, the pain is created or amplified in the brain and felt in the body. How? So brain normally maintains an equilibrium among networks of neurons that enhance pain and those that decrease pain. But under certain circumstances, the brain networks that enhance pain get agitated and they send the pain signal down to the body where we feel it. Here is a striking example of how it plays out in an acute pain. This is an almost 3-decade-old picture of a construction worker boot who's jumped on a 6-inch nail. The nail went through his entire shoe, entering on the bottom and exiting on the top. Trick question, was he in pain? They had to take him to the ER and sedate him. But when they finally removed the boot, there was nothing, not even a scratch on the foot. The nail managed to find its way between his toes to the top of the shoe without any injury. Yet the brain decided there was one based on what it saw. Here is a nail sticking out of the boot. It looks painful and dangerous. So it created pain signal and the person felt real pain in his foot. And why would our brain do that? This leads me to the third principle of chronic pain. The brain regions that regulate pain look different in people with chronic pain as opposed to people without chronic pain. Areas in the brain that have the capacity to either increase or decrease pain also regulate our mood, memory, long-term planning, and sleep. They create our personality, our emotions, the sense of who we are, and where we belong in the world. Areas most frequently identified in chronic pain studies are part of neuronal networks that assign meaning to the input our brain receives from the body. To paraphrase the words of a famous brain pain researcher, Dr. Torweger, our experience of chronic pain is entangled with our understanding of what the pain means to us. Which leads me to the fourth principle of chronic pain. The brain changes are reversible. Our brain learns the pain. Our brain constantly scans for and finds threats in the environment. Upon finding a threat, a stress response is triggered, and repeated hits of these threat detections lead to chronic stress response. It is generally accepted in the scientific community that stress response is disproportionately involved in pain generation. It is also postulated that pain is one of many physiological symptoms of chronic stress response. Our brain learns to respond to a perceived threat with pain, and it can unlearn it. A group of researchers at University of Colorado studied 150 patients with chronic back pain, low back pain. 50 of them were submitted to a novel protocol referred to as pain reprocessing therapy. The author of this protocol is Alan Gordon. The gist of this approach lies in reframing the meaning of most chronic pain as a reversible brain-generated phenomenon. The study participants' brains were scanned before and after intervention, which consisted of 8 psychological treatment sessions over a 4-week period, and the results were astounding. 33 out of 50 participants reported either complete or near complete resolution of their pain, and most of them maintained it at a 1-year follow-up. In my rheumatology practice, I witness the best results in patients who are ready and willing to receive all of the information I just shared with you. I divide it into 3 steps. Returning to my patient, Amelia, step number 1 was to validate and educate. I explained to Amelia that the pain was 100% real, despite completely normal exam. That the pain creates, that the brain creates, and then learns the pain in response to a perceived threat. Amelia was willing to embrace this concept, and that notion alone was a huge game changer and resulted in improvement in her symptoms within a week. Our brain has power over our pain. Our brain is us. The pain is not. Number two, reframe the meaning of chronic pain. Chronic pain does not equal danger. Teach your brain how to feel safe. I showed Emilia how to create the sensation of safety by triggering a relaxation response. I used a technique similar to the one used in Colorado Boulder study. She leaned against her chair and closed her eyes. She then slowed down her breathing by taking a slightly deeper breath. I then guided her to focus her attention on her pain as if she were meeting it for the first time, without any judgment. I then offered the words of reassurance for her brain that included, "Dear brain, I am now learning that the pain I feel is a message of threat from you. And I want you to know, dear brain, that I'm safe. This is just a sensation. It's going to pass." By slowing down her breathing while focusing on pain, she was creating the sensation of safety. She was teaching her brain that the pain was safe. This technique resulted in immediate, transient, complete improvement in her symptoms. And this served two purposes. Number one, it was a proof to her that the pain relief was available. And number two, that it was available to her, that she can do it herself. Our brain has power over our pain. Our brain is us. The pain is not. And finally, number three, believe in your brain's capacity to reduce pain. Self-doubt increases stress response and makes pain relief less likely. High levels of confidence in our brain's capacity to reduce pain improve pain outcomes in multiple categories, including pain intensity and function. In summary, all chronic pain is real. The presence and intensity of our pain is determined by our brain. Our brain has the capacity to create and learn pain in response to a threat. And out of all elements that seem to affect this process, our ability to reframe the meaning of pain and our ability to believe seem to be the most relevant in improving pain outcomes. Our brain has power over our pain. Our brain is us. The pain is not. Thank you.